Welcome everyone to the Dining Etiquette Table Manners video. I am thrilled to finally bring this highly requested video to you. This stemmed off of my video that I did way back, 5 tips to being a classy lady. If you have not watched that video, which has gotten well over 1 million views, I will have it linked in the drop-down box below this video. I will also have outfit details to the look that I am wearing here, as well as the look that you will see in the actual footage that was taken at the restaurant. Table manners can tell a lot about someone. It can tell a lot about their refinement, their upbringing, their self-awareness of other people, their respect for others. I don't want anyone to feel overwhelmed by the information that I am going to share today. This really is to help prevent you from having an embarrassing moment. That is really the purpose. Also, bear in mind that we all do things differently when it comes to dining in different parts of the world. Not everything that I share with you today is going to apply in other parts of the world. That is okay. Even if you don't practice impeccable table manners in the privacy of your own home, it is important to know proper dining etiquette for those times when you do need to use it. I also would recommend that maybe you do perhaps practice it in the privacy of your own home. What will happen is these simple steps and tools will become second nature for you, and when you do need to step up your game when it comes to table manners and dining etiquette, it will be much easier because it will be very natural for you. You will always be prepared for those occasions when you do need to use these tools. Today, we are going to talk about simple guidelines for you to utilize during the whole course of your meal. This is going to start right from the beginning of arriving to someone's home or a restaurant, all the way to when you leave. In hopes to make it easier for you to follow, I am going to share these tips in order. Because we all have them on us, I want to start with our smartphones. Ideally, you would silence your phone prior to going into someone's home or into a restaurant, but if you have not, you will want to silence your phone and put it away immediately upon arriving to where you are going to dine. Worst case scenario, you would do it as soon as you arrive to the table. If you are a gentleman, you will silence your phone and you will put it in your sport coat. If you are a lady, you will silence your phone and you will put it in your handbag. Your phone should never be anywhere visible on the table where your dining guests can see it. Now, let me just say, if you are in a casual environment and you are out with all of your girlfriends and you're all going to be taking pictures and we're doing the Snapchat and Instagram stories thing, and you know everybody is on board, I would say that may be okay, but only in that case. Always better to err on the proper side and not have your phone around. If you are in that situation, you want to have respect for those around you. Maybe your girlfriends at your table all have their phones out and they're all snapping pictures and they're all laughing and having a good time, but you need to have respect for those that are around your table. I would say always err on the classy side and don't have your phone out. Let's talk about seating for a moment. If you are dining at someone else's home, you generally would want to wait for a signal or a cue for when it is actually time to sit down at the table. You will usually pick up on that. Just pay close attention. Generally, the host will tell you to go be seated or where you're going to sit, or you will just get the vibe for when it's time because they will be going to seat themselves. If you are at a restaurant, as soon as you are seated, and again, phone is silenced and put away, the very first thing that you do is you put your napkin on your lap. Think of it like going to bed at night. You get into a bed, you pull your covers over top of you immediately. Same concept with the napkin. As soon as you're seated, you put the napkin on your lap. Sometimes, if you are at a more casual restaurant, Your utensils will be wrapped up inside the napkin. If that is the case, you would unroll your utensils from the napkin, you would place your knife to the right, your fork to the left, and then you would place your napkin on your lap. You don't need to be real fussy about the way the napkin is positioned on your lap, but if you were looking to step things up a little bit and wondered what is the proper position of your napkin on your lap, generally the fold is towards you and the opening is away from you. If you are in really formal settings, sometimes the wait staff will place the napkin on your lap for you, but again, that is only going to be in really formal settings. Some of you may have never experienced that before, but now you will know why it's being done if you are ever in that really formal setting. The proper thing to do is just sit back and allow the wait staff or the host to place the napkin where they would like and then just graciously thank them. Now that the napkin is on your lap, it's very important for you to remember that at this point, the napkin will never get placed on the table again. So once the napkin is on your lap, it will never get placed on the table. If you need to get up to use the restroom, you will get up and you will place your napkin on your seat. Some people prefer to put their napkin to the left of their plate. I never do, especially once my napkin has been used to dab my mouth, because you never want anybody to see any residue on your napkin. That is why I always recommend putting the napkin in your seat. Go to the restroom. When you come back, you pick up your napkin, you place it back in your lap. It never hits the table. Also, remember that your napkin is your friend. There's a purpose for the napkin. The important thing is not to be wiping. Don't think wipe, but think blot. Also, again, you never want to show any exposed food or beverage, lipstick, whatever, to where your other guests can see it. So it's always important to keep that portion concealed once you are using your napkin. It's very simple. Just remember, blot, don't wipe. Let's move on to ordering, and we are going to start with drinks. Often, your water glass is already on the table when you arrive. A wait person has already taken care of that. On the other hand, if you are in a very casual environment, you may not see that, and they may take your drink order and ask if you would like water, or you may just have to order it yourself. That's where dining etiquette and table manners gets a little bit tricky. I'm really gauging this video for a little bit nicer than just your basic everyday restaurant where you're getting a paper napkin wrapped up with your utensils in it. That's really not where I'm going with today's video. I'm going a step up, or even a couple steps up from that. If your water is already on the table, or even if it's not, and a wait staff brings it to you, you will notice that it will be positioned to your right, and that is correct, and that is where you are going to want to leave your water. If you are at a very fine dining restaurant, you may see one or two additional glasses sitting at your spot. Those are going to be wine glasses. Generally, you're going to have a white wine and a red wine glass. Those glasses will also be positioned to the right. Your drinks always go to the right, and I'll give you a little tip in a minute to help you remember where it goes. If you will not be drinking wine, of course your wait staff will ask you that, you would say no thank you, and he or she will remove the wine glasses. On the other hand, if you will be drinking wine, you may want to consider ordering a bottle. Generally, if two or more people at the table are going to be drinking wine and they agree on a wine together, it's better to do a bottle. You're going to actually save more that way. And you also have the option of selecting perhaps a little bit finer bottle of wine than what they are serving as the house wine. Don't hesitate to ask your guest if any of them are going to be having wine, and then you can ask, do you like a Chardonnay? Do you like a Pinot Noir? Are you a Cabernet person? That will help you be the judge if ordering a bottle of wine would be suitable. If your guests are planning on drinking wine but are uncertain of what wine they would like, and you are an experienced wine drinker, you can always ask them what they plan on having as their entree, and then you can make a suggestion based off of that. Recognize that food and wine are like peanut butter and jelly. Some wines pair better with certain foods. Feel free as well to ask your wait staff if they have a recommendation of what wine to pair with the entrees that are being ordered. If you are at a really fine dining establishment, they will most likely have a sommelier that can make that recommendation for you. Let's talk about if you are drinking wine. Many people are not aware of how to hold a wine glass. And I am happy to share that with you. And again, if you don't sweat it, but if you want to know the proper, I am here to provide that for you. When drinking wine, you always hold the wine glass on the stem. You don't cup the glass, you don't actually touch the glass part, but you hold your wine glass by the stem. I don't want to get carried away with the wine because that could be a whole new video. And don't forget, I do have a little bit of an educational wine video talking about bubbly, sparkling wine. I will be sure to have that video linked in the drop-down box below and also on the corresponding blog post. At this point, drinks are all ordered, so let's move on to the dinner selections. Let me share a little tip that my husband and I do prior to going out with other couples or other people when we are going to dine. What will generally happen is the couples will arrive at the restaurant and everybody gets talking. We're catching up on what everybody's doing, what's going on in your lives, what vacations have you took, how's your kids, and the conversation gets started. What happens is nobody really has taken the time to look at the menu, and it's very hard to stop and pause and do that. My husband and I always tend to look up the menu online prior to going to the restaurant. We get ourselves familiar and we have a good idea of what we are going to order. Now, in a lot of establishments, there may be some features of the night, so you may change your mind, and that's okay. But at least you go there with a little bit of a plan. Remember, failing to plan is planning to fail. I am definitely one of those people that feel it's good to be a little well-versed with the establishment that you're going to be dining at. Tip number two with dinner selection, don't be difficult. Don't be difficult. Nobody likes to dine with that difficult person that is watching everything they eat. They're taking this off the salad. They're asking to have the fish made this way or the chicken made this way. This is not the place to do it. It is not classy, nor is it respectful to make all of these modifications. If you are doing that, you are stealing all of the attention to yourself. I'm not saying that it's not okay to make a minor substitution, but you don't want to hold up your wait staff, nor do you want to give the impression that you are just a high maintenance person. Another little tip that I want to share is read the menu. If the menu has what the side offerings to your entree are, when you give the waiter your order and they ask you what two sides would you like, it's disrespectful to ask him or her what the sides are if it is noted on the menu. So pay attention to your menu. The key is you should never hold anybody up. You shouldn't hold your guest up and you shouldn't hold your wait staff up. You and your guest are all looking at the menu. Dinner selections are made. Then you close your menu and you leave your menu on top of your plate or to the side. The key is you want it closed and set out. That signals to the wait staff that you are ready to make your selection. When the waiter or waitress comes, they will take your order and they will remove the menus for you. Now let's talk a little bit about body language. And there's a lot to say about this. And again, we go back to refinement, being poised, being classy. And there's a lot about body language that we learn in our upbringing. So if you have small children, start teaching them all of these tips and tricks as young as you can. Again, it will become second nature for them to implement these. When sitting at the table, your posture should be nice and tall and upright. Also, keep your elbows off the table, but I will share a time when you can perhaps put them back on the table. Body language when you are actually eating is one hand in your lap while the other hand is on your utensil. Most people are right-handed, therefore their left hand would be in their lap and their right hand would be on their utensil, except when they are picking up their fork to cut something. Let's go back to elbows on the table. The only time that it is okay to put your elbows on the table and slightly lean in is either before ordering the meal, after you are done eating, or in between courses. If you are engaging in conversation with your guest and you lean your elbows on the table and you slightly lean in, it shows your guest that you are engaged in the conversation and that you are listening with intent. But anytime there is food on the table, again, hand in lap, other hand would be on your utensil. Let's move on to the tricky one, place setting. And this is the one that really gets people tripped up. We already talked about the drinks. We talked about the water glass being to the right, the wine glass, whatever it is. If you're drinking a draft beer, it's going to the right. If you're drinking a soda, it's going to the right. Whatever it is, coffee, tea, it's always to the right of you, up above your plate. But let's discuss the bread plate. Now, this generally won't trip people up. Where does the bread plate go? Where does my drink go? Unless you are seated beside people. Think about if you are at a wedding reception and you are at a banquet table and everyone is seated next to each other and you have glasses on the table and you have bread plates on the table and you're not sure which one is my bread plate and which one's my water glass. I'm not sure which direction to go. I'm going to give you a little tip or trick to remind yourself which one is yours. Once you know this, you will never forget it. B and D. B is for bread, D is for drink. So always remember B and D. Now, if you are ever dining and you see somebody go, you'll know why. But let's move on to utensils because this also really gives people some anxiety. We already discussed that sometimes your knife and fork are going to be rolled up into your napkin and you would unroll them, place the napkin on your lap. You would put your knife to the right and your fork to the left. This is very popular in your chain restaurant establishments. In a little bit more finer dining restaurants, generally your utensils are already going to be positioned where they belong at your place setting. Often what you will see is two, sometimes three forks, extra plates. Generally that's going to be your bread plate, and you may even see a couple spoons. If you're at a really nice restaurant, you will even see utensils up at the top of your plate, and sometimes you will even see a small little fork. This can all seem very, very confusing, but don't panic. Again, once you remember some of these principles, you will never forget them. And if you do panic, don't show it. The most important thing is to always hold yourself nice and tall, posture up, smile on your face, and don't let anybody know that you're trying to figure things out. We already talked about our drinks and we talked about our bread, so we're honing in on those utensils. One of the things to me that's a no-brainer is clearly anything that is served on a flat plate is going to be eaten with a fork, and anything that comes in a bowl is going to be eaten with a spoon. I think we should all know that, but if for some reason you don't, now you do. Some of your pasta dishes will actually come in a little bit more of a bowl type thing, and you will actually have a spoon inserted or presented with that pasta dish. That spoon is used as a tool to get maybe your pasta twisted around on your fork. Really, the biggest thing to remember with your utensils and when you have several in front of you is you are going to work from the outside in. So when you take your very first fork to, let's say, eat your salad, you want to take the fork that is the furthest out. Your forks are on your left, and again, you could have two or three. Your knife and your spoons are on your right. But again, take that fork from the outside. That is for your salad. When your entree comes, you're going to use the other fork. When the wait staff takes your salad off the table when you're done with it, your fork is going to be with it. All right, let's talk about where we're at right now. So our drinks are on the table. We've got our meal now. All of our place settings are out. Napkin is on lap. It's very easy to want to just dive right in, but there's a couple little things that, out of courtesy and respect, that you need to note. Whether or not you are eating in someone's home or at a restaurant, you generally do not eat any of your food until the rest of the guests have received theirs. Let's say you are out with two other couples. So you and your significant other are out with two other couples. There's six of you. Let's just say that four of the entrees get brought to the table, but two don't. Those four people that have their entree in front of them, they don't start diving in until the other two entrees are brought to the table. You always wait, and this also applies in the home. Now, generally, most people would say, oh, go ahead and get started eating. Don't wait for us. And that is what I always do. If somebody insists that, then go ahead, but never just do it on your own. So we're getting ready to eat. Let's talk about holding your utensils. There's two styles, the American and the Continental style. I'm pretty much going to be talking about the American style because that is what we do here. I actually like the continental style better. I feel like it makes more sense to eat that way. But if you're used to the American style and you grew up eating that way, you are just flustered. I have tried. I can't do the continental style for nothing. So just stick with how the proper way or how you were taught where you live. Generally, the American style, you are holding your utensil in your right hand, your dominant hand. So that is where your fork is going to be. That is where your spoon is going to be. Whatever you are eating at that time and whatever appropriate utensil, it's generally going to be in your right hand, your dominant hand. With the American style, when you want to cut something, you actually switch your fork to your left hand. You pick up your knife with your right hand, and that is how you cut your food. And again, the continental style would not be that way. Another very important tip when it comes to cutting, you never cut up your whole entire salad at once or your whole entire piece of protein like steak, chicken. You don't cut it all up at once. What you do is you cut one bite at a time, and that is what you eat. So you make your cut, you take your bite, you can set your utensil down, or you can still hold your fork in your right hand. But then when you are ready to make your next cut, you will switch that fork over to the left hand, you will pick up your knife, you will make your cut, then you will switch back and you will take your bite. The other thing, let me just share with bread. You don't butter your whole entire bread. You break off a piece of bread, you put a little butter on that piece, and you eat that piece. Let's say you need some salt. You never ever reach across the table, whether at a restaurant or in someone's home, to get the salt. You always ask, please pass the salt. The other thing to remember is if somebody asks you to pass the salt, you always pass the pepper with the salt. Salt and pepper always stay together. They never get separated. If somebody asks for the pepper, please, you pass the salt with the pepper. Let's talk a little bit about finger foods. Believe it or not, of course, there are finger foods, and it is very appropriate to do just that, eat them with your fingers. Think pizza, think wings, think tacos, corn on the cob, a burger. But often you are going to be in that type of establishment. If you can eat something with your fork or use a fork and knife, I encourage you to do so. Let's say you are out for pizza and you're at a nicer restaurant. If you can eat your pizza with a fork and knife, it is going to be a cleaner look. It's not inappropriate to pick up your pizza because it is a finger food, but I am just encouraging you to give it a shot because it does look much cleaner and classier, and who really wants to get a big mess on their fingers anyway? And don't forget, with a napkin, you blot, and you don't want any of that exposed blot to be seen by other people. Chewing and talking. This really should be a no-brainer, but it really amazes me how many people cannot articulate the fact that when you have food in your mouth and you are chewing, you don't talk. It is a struggle for some people. It really is. And it's unfortunate. But again, it could be upbringing. I'm not really sure. Pay attention. Just clearly pay attention. Self-awareness is key when it comes to eating, when it comes to dining etiquette, when it comes to having good table manners, when it comes to being poised and refined. Pay attention to what you are doing. Don't talk with food in your mouth. Don't chew with your mouth open. Don't smack when you're chewing. Don't slurp. Don't bite your utensils. Just pay attention. Be aware. Be aware of what you're doing. The best way to avoid mishaps like these is to take smaller bites. If you take a smaller bite and you are chewing and someone asks you a question, because you have a smaller bite, you're generally going to be able to chew up that food and engage right back into that conversation. But if you have a mouthful, number one, it just doesn't look good. It just, you know, the big wad over the cheek, it doesn't look good. But it's always better to just motion, like just one moment, than to start talking because you get anxious and you don't know what to do. It's okay to just say one moment or pick up your napkin and cover your mouth, whatever you need to do. Taking a drink. So you're eating your food and now you need to take a drink. Now, it's not necessarily a no-no to take a drink if there's food still in your mouth, but you generally don't want to do that because it's going to leave food particles on your glass, and that is never classy. It's really important to take a bite, and whenever you want to take a drink, You blot your mouth to make sure no food particles are there. But again, make sure you've chewed everything up so there's no remnants. Blot your mouth, then you take a drink, and that should prevent you from having any food particles on your glass. The other thing, ladies, a little tip with lipstick. Lipstick just doesn't look nice on a glass. All of us lipstick wearers, we've all been there. I've been there for sure, and I'm always like, I don't like that. I think if you really pay attention to what lipsticks you are wearing when you are going to dine out can make a world of difference. I definitely have lipsticks that transfer, but I also have lipsticks that have such good staying power, maybe they're a little bit more matte and they don't transfer at all. So pay attention to that because nobody wants to see it on your napkin. And again, you're trying to avoid anybody seeing that, but you also don't want to see it on your glass and you don't want anybody else to either. Let's talk about eating foods that you don't like. Now, when you're at a restaurant, you pretty much can order whatever you like. So if you didn't like something, perhaps you just didn't order the right thing. Or maybe you ordered something that you generally like, but it just didn't taste good. The key is you don't make a fuss. Again, don't draw attention to yourself. Everybody else could really be enjoying their food and you don't want to take away from that. So just be silent. You don't need to share it with anybody. If somebody notices that you're not really eating your food and they ask you about it, don't give a lot of information. You don't need to make anybody look bad. You don't want to make the restaurant look bad. You don't want to make the wait staff look bad. Don't talk negatively at all about your food, the establishment, or any of the staff that is working, even if you feel something is inappropriate, or if you feel like the wait was too long, or you feel like your food is not warm enough. Just don't make a fuss. If you do need to send something back for any reason, do so, but don't make a fuss when doing it. A refined lady or gentleman would never cause that type of attention to themselves. But let's say you're dining at someone else's home and you are served something that you just don't like. How do you handle it? Well, again, you don't draw attention to yourself and you never come out and say, "I don't like that." That's just not a classy way to handle it. It's always better to say no thank you or to try a little bit. You never know, and it is respectful to try something. If you are asked by the host, "What do you think?" and you are clearly eating something that you don't like, you don't necessarily have to give a big lie, but this is when a little white lie could kind of come in play, but it's all how you say it. You could say it looks delicious because you're not actually saying it tastes delicious, but you're giving it a compliment and that is going to make the host feel good for all of their effort. Or you could say, "Boy, it's flavorful," because again, you're not saying that you like it, but you're definitely not saying that you dislike it. You could also say, "Boy, I can tell you are quite the cook." And I think that is a wonderful compliment. There's a good chance the host or hostess is going to take that as a real positive and a real compliment. And the whole key here is we always want to leave people better than we found them. If you recall in my Classy Lady video, I talk all the time, leave people better than you found them. Always pay somebody a good compliment. Now, let's say you're going to be hosting in your home. What I would recommend you do is when you give out the invite to the person or the people, you would ask them if they or their spouse or whomever could be coming with them has a food allergy, any sensitivities to food, or just have any main entrees that they really just don't like. But again, you want to do this when you're reaching out to your guest. By doing so, you can plan and prepare, and it will also give you the confidence where you don't have to worry if somebody is going to like something that you made or not. I also wouldn't make real spicy dishes because not everybody likes spicy. So if you are hosting in your home, try to think of entrees, main dishes, salads that most people are generally going to like. And often you will kind of know this if you know your guest on a little bit more personal level anyway. Let's talk about excusing yourself from the table. Now, that is not uncommon, and there is nothing wrong with having to excuse yourself from the table to go to the restroom. What you want to avoid is making a scene. You don't need to explain why you are going to the restroom. You don't need to say, "I've been drinking coffee all day and it's going right through me." All you have to say is, "Excuse me, I have to go to the restroom." Now again, when you get up, you are going to place your napkin folded so that nobody can see any of the food particles on your napkin. So fold the napkin so all you see is clean and you place it in your seat. Talking about excusing ourselves, let's segue a little bit into the cell phone usage. Now let's just say that you potentially do have to receive a call while you are out dining. Hopefully you have made arrangements where that is not the case, but let's say you do, or let's just say you have small children and you are going to have your phone readily available. I'll be completely honest with you, with a large family and for many years having small children, I do somewhat keep my phone a little bit readily available because in an emergency, if my husband and I are out, we need to be contacted. If I know I'm going to be contacted, I communicate right up front that I'm going to have my phone next to me. I may hear from the babysitter, or when we leave the restaurant tonight, we have to pick up one of our daughters from a party and she's going to text me with the time. Communicating is always key if you do, and people are not going to mind. What is really disrespectful is when you are just checking your phone or you have your phone out or whatever you're doing. So again, pay attention to who you're with and don't hesitate to communicate if you are with people that just don't already know these things. If I'm out with my mother, certainly I can check my phone and she can as well if we are waiting for something. But you know when it's okay and you also know when you may be overstepping that boundary. But let's just say your phone does go off and if you are a lady, you look down in your handbag and you do need to take it. You just say, "Excuse me," you take your phone and you leave. You never answer your phone while you're at the table. All you have to do is grab your phone and say, "Excuse me." You don't need to ask, you don't need to give an explanation. But again, hopefully you have communicated this up front. You walk away and you take the call. You never talk on your phone while you are in the dining area of a restaurant where other people can hear you. That is definitely a no-no. You would get up, you would go out to the lobby section, you would go outside, perhaps you could go into a restroom. But again, you want to be respectful of the people around you. I think it really boils down to that, and we have gotten so far away from the respect of others. Let's talk about being part of the group. So you are out with, let's say, two other couples. Let's say there's six of you. Dinner is meant to be social. It really is. Let's face it, everything to do with eating is social as well. What you want to pay attention to is that you are making an effort to stay engaged with the people at your party. Also, be careful not to give one person all the attention. Let's say there's three couples, so there's three ladies. Try to make sure that the conversation includes all three of you. In conversation, clearly you want to avoid topics that could stir up any emotions or opinions that may be different than yours. I think we already know the certain topics: avoid politics, avoid religion, avoid maybe whether or not you got the flu shot or not. Just anything that you think could spark somebody's opinion to be different than yours and a little bit of controversy, just don't bring it up. Only bring up things that are positive and asking people what's going on in their life. And if somebody does sway down one of those paths, don't chime in or just kind of try to reroute the conversation if you have the opportunity without coming off rude like you're interrupting, because you don't want to interrupt anybody. Always pay attention to that. And we talk a lot about that in the Classy Lady video. Don't be that person that owns the whole conversation. If you are out and there's six of you, recognize if you are generally the only one talking. There's a problem with that. So again, be aware, pace yourself, and make sure everybody is contributing. Also, listen with intent. It is so easy when somebody brings up something for us to chime in with how we would do it, or we did that, or we went on that trip, or you need to do this. Just listen with intent. If they didn't ask your opinion, be careful how much of it you are putting out there. I mentioned this earlier, but again, in conversation, never comment on what another person is eating. Never comment to the lady, "Oh, you're eating the bread. Oh, I can't have the bread." If you don't want the bread because you're watching your diet, that's fine. You don't need to announce it, but you also don't need to comment if somebody else has three pieces of bread. To each their own, and a respectful person who has confidence would never question or compare themselves to another individual. And often it really does boil down to you're really just comparing. You're almost trying to one up. I'm better than you because I can avoid the bread, but you can't. Don't be that person. Also, if somebody is eating something that you just could never imagine eating, let's say oysters, mussels. My husband and I, we love oysters, we love mussels. We're foodies, and we love a lot of things that you're sometimes more typical, not foodie type people that never really cultivated their palates. They just don't like it. A lot of them have never even tried it. And often my husband and I don't order some of those things if we feel that could make people uncomfortable, but never comment like, how can you eat mussels? Ugh! How can you eat, No. Think about it. What did I just look like? No, don't ever do it. Just don't. Another thing to avoid talking about is diet. You're on a diet, this diet, I did that diet. What are you doing for a diet? Diet. Ladies are notorious for this. Thank you, men, that you generally don't do this, but ladies are notorious for it. If you are out dining or dining in somebody's home or dining at all, it's just not a time to talk about diet. Think about it. We're eating. It's social. We're in conversation. Let it go. Just let it go for the night. Another very important and key thing that I always try to do, because I am by nature a fast eater, and I think a lot of that comes with having a big family, and we were always racing around, running the roads, eat dinner, get out, we have practice, we have to go here, there. I am sure many of you can relate to this. Really what has happened is I've just became a very fast eater. My husband is as well, and I would actually say most of our kids are because they've watched us. You're a product of what you've observed. But I really try to, when I'm out dining with other people, to pay attention to how fast or how slow everyone else is eating. And I try to pace myself accordingly. If I am out with other diners that tend to eat faster, then I'm okay with that. I will eat at the pace that they are. But if I'm dining and I notice that everybody has a little bit more on their plate than I do, I will slow myself down and try to stay at the same pace as them. So again, be self-aware, be observant. Let's say you need to get your server. Maybe you want the bill, maybe you have to leave. What do you do? Well, let me share with you what you don't do. You never reach your arm up in the air like this and say, server, hey, server. And you really don't ever lift your arm up like this at all. Signaling something like that with your arm close to you and down is okay, but it should be very, very subtle. But generally, your server, when they are in the vicinity of the tables that they are waiting on, they are observant. They are watching for cues from their customers if they are needed. So really, all you generally need to do is lean back slightly and give them a look and a little nod or whatever, and they will pick up that they are needed. You don't need to make a scene. Again, we've talked before, don't draw that type of negative attention to yourself. Let's talk about ending the meal. So you are all done eating. Now, you may or may not have food left over that you would like to take home, but the utensil situation doesn't change either way. When you are done eating, again, napkin does not go on the table. Now, some people put it to the left, but at this point, I don't. Napkin stays on my lap. I am done eating. Where you position your utensils actually signals to your server that you are done. So it is important that you know where to put those. Now, backing up, because I didn't mention this earlier, when you are actually eating your meal, your utensils, once used, should never touch the table. Once your fork and your knife have went into your food, you never place them on the table. What you do with your utensils when you are not using them, for instance, your knife, when you are not making a cut, it goes at the top of your plate. Your fork just leans on your plate for the next time that you are going to take a bite. So again, nothing goes on the table. When you are done eating, you put your utensils at the 10 and 4 position. So if your plate was a clock, you would have your handles to your utensils at the 4 o'clock, and the blades would be up at the 10 position. that signals to your server that you are done. When your server comes, if there is food left on your plate, generally they will ask if you would like that boxed up, and that is when you can tell them yes or no. The key is you signaled to them that it was time to take your plate. Now, if you are going to be staying at the restaurant or at the dinner table if you are in someone's home for longer, and you are going to be engaging in post-dinner conversations or perhaps have an after-dinner cocktail or have an espresso, whatever you may choose, this is when you can put your elbows slightly on the table. I usually put my forearms, not necessarily my elbows, and I lean in because I am engaging in conversation and there is no food on the table. Again, at this point, my napkin is still in my lap. Some people, again, have put it to the left and it will remain there unless the wait staff grabbed it. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But again, I leave my napkin in my lap the whole entire time. And really, I don't know if it's being a lady and knowing that I am a lipstick wearer, and I just don't want anybody to see any of that residue on my napkin. When I exit the table, I generally will still put my napkin in my chair. Sometimes as I'm standing to exit, I will place it to the left of where I was sitting because nobody would really see because we are actually exiting. So don't overanalyze it. Find what works for you. Placing it to the left, again, many people do, placing it on your seat. I'll let you be the judge of that, but I just prefer the seat. That pretty much covers it. And let me just end with the fact that not everyone is going to be offended if you don't follow these guidelines. I really don't even pay much attention to what other people are doing because I'm more focused on how I am behaving. And I talk about that all the time. We are so quick to judge others, but we're never wanting to improve ourselves. I'm paying more attention to what I am doing. And often many people just were not taught these things, and I don't hold that against them. The only time I may feel a little, is if somebody is doing something extreme. We're talking chewing their food and talking at the same time, or chewing with their mouth open and it's just obnoxiously loud. Then I would never say anything, but I am definitely feeling it's unfortunate that they just were never taught. That's generally how I feel, or that they're just not aware. I think it's just a shame that they weren't aware. And again, if you practice these things often, even if it's just you and your spouse, and you can be more relaxed, and nobody's gonna care where you put your napkin, and nobody's gonna care if you're on your phone, and nobody cares if your knife touches the table after it's touched your food. I get that, and that's great, and that's fine. But if you want to articulate and have these guidelines be second nature, the more you practice them, the more easier it becomes, and now it's just natural to do it. Always remember that people are appreciative when they see that others make a conscious effort to do things right. They just really are. There you have it, the long-awaited dining etiquette table manners video, so that you can be more ladylike when you are dining out or if you are in somebody's home, or you can be more of a gentleman. Whoever it is watching, this is for everyone. Don't hesitate to teach your children these principles. I'm telling you, if you have a job, or you think someday that you will, that is business oriented, there are many people that part of the interview process, whether you know it or not, is going out for lunch with your prospective new boss. They can tell a lot about a person by dining with them. Pay attention. Be prepared. Again, failing to plan is planning to fail. All right. Thank you so much. Let me know. Comments, suggestions of what you would like to see next, having to do possibly with just being a better person, having some of these skills, characteristics, and traits locked in so that you know what to do to be more classy. I'm always open to your suggestions. We'll see you in the next video. Take care.